girl Monifa, and you're tuned in to Brunch in the Basement with JaVonne and Terez.
Still in the basement, no longer alone, with my homegirl Terez on the microphone. Music politics are just chatting it up. Brunch in the basement, see that's what's up. You never know who might run through. Legendary artists or someone brand new. You miss a lot when you miss one day. At least that's what I heard somebody say. But it doesn't really matter what whoever says. It's always a good show with JaVonne and Terez. Yeah. Brunch in the basement with JaVonne and Terez. Yeah. Let's see who we got today or what we doing today or whatever it is, it's gonna be good. Woo!
Yeah.
Come on, everybody's a friend in my head. I already know everybody. One day I'll tell you about me and Chaka Khan, but you know.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. But she doesn't know anything about got it. But anyway. No, she doesn't. She wasn't even there, actually. But anyway.
The time, so.
And we thank you for that.
Thank you.
Yes, thank
well, thank you. This part, that little piece, I'm just going to keep and play it all the time for myself. But no, I'm just teasing. Hey, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. I am hoping that you can all hear me very well. And the first thing I have to say is that this broadcast is licensed via 365 and covers listeners in the USA through Sound Exchange, ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC. The artists will get their royalties for all the music that is played on this show. In Canada, through SoCan and Resound, and the UK through PPL and PRS. Thank you, everybody, for showing up today. And this is going to be an amazing show. Today we have with us the voice of the legendary Brand New Heavies. Can't wait for her to call in. This is going to be so good. And she's got that UK sound, you know, that R&B, neo-soul, house music thing going on with her. And when I think the UK, for me, I always think Karen Wheeler. That's just my thing, right? And here's a song that Karen had not released publicly, so this is sort of exclusive just for us. Let's do it, whatever it takes.
Make it better. Oh, yeah.
aren't there. I need you, baby. So be prepared for me to love you like never before. Trust me, baby, I'll love you more.
And we can do so
many so
things better,
better.
When it's over and done, and it's time to move along. Let all that's done, all that's done, be done. And I can find myself moving through that open door.
to WJBR Internet Radio, Brunch in the Basement with JaVonne and Terez.
You with the sad eyes, don't be discouraged, though I realize it's hard to take courage in a world full of people. You can lose sight of it all. The darkness that's inside you makes you feel so small. But I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true kindness, true beautiful, like a rainbow. Show me a smile then, don't be unhappy, can't remember when I last saw you laughing. If this world makes you crazy and you've taken all you can bear, just call me up and I'll always be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. don't be afraid to let them show your true kindness, beautiful like a rainbow. Call me up and I'll always be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true kindness, true kindness shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. So don't you be afraid to let them show your true kindness, true kindness. A beautiful like a rainbow. Oh, 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 oh,
your body,
You know I want it all. Can I have it all? Cause you do things to me that nobody else could and nobody else would. So dim the lights and light the fire, and let's just be close together.
You're listening to WJBR Internet Radio, Brunch in the Basement with JaVonne and Terez.
Good morning.
And that was Background Betty singing.
Background Betty.
Play with you. That was a nice song. You know what? I don't know what made me play it. And it's like I have that album up in the queue always. It's just always there. And I played something, I don't remember what the song was I played before, but it was nice and mellow, and I saw that the BPMs on that song was around the same, you know, mellow kind of vibe, and I said, I think I just found me a new favorite Monifa song. That shit is a nice vibe right there.
Nice.
Nah.
I forget the title of one of my faves. I think it's from that album.
You actually told me what it was before, and we played it, and it was dope. It was freaking dope.
Too late. That's what it is.
Yes. That song is it's the truth.
Yeah.
And it's so funny because I was looking this morning at. As in every Saturday morning, y'all don't understand how much I love y'all. It's just like, y'all just don't know. You don't know and they don't know, but that's all right because they don't know about this thing. Don't know what people say.
Yeah. That's, you know, Craig.
Say what?
Is that Craig David? John B.
Yeah, so I was looking for video, you know, just to change up that little intro thing that I created, where I've been playing recently. First, I started with Leon saying, "Hi, this is Leon, Brunch in the Basement, whatever," and you're listening, you know, his drop, and then I've been playing it with N'Dea's drop, and so I said, you know, let me let me look through, because I want to keep it fresh. You know what I'm saying? Like a different, we've had so many brilliant, wonderful artists come on. We asked them for a drop, and you know, my time has been crazy, even though I'm in the house. But
in the house.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? It's like I'm always, you know, but I wanted to utilize another drop. So I said, oh, Terrell, I haven't looked at that video in a while. So the drops usually come at the end of the show. So I fast forwarded all the way to the end. Who's there? Background Betty looking fierce in her red with hair all done up. So I'm trying to go back. I'm thinking, oh, right. We did get a visual drop from her that day. So I said, let me go back a little. She was on like a whole, we gave her a whole nother show because she had things on her mind.
Oh, that was her and Terrell, right? Oh, gosh.
Oh, my God. Terrell had long been gone. We had a whole nother show with background. And it was dope. It was dope. but she, you know, she's always dope. And to me, she's just freaking hysterical. I have to really take some time because, like I said, I did it this morning. But now that I've retrieved that video and put it in the system, mm-hmm. you know, in my little editing software thingy, I'm going to chop that thing up and we're going to be throwing up clips of her giving me the finger and all kinds of stuff.
No, please.
All the background Betty shenanigans, because you know what, though? It was live and on the air. It's not like people can't see it, you know? It's just out there. It's already out there. She did it. It was done. She's like, Jay, this is for you. Or something.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, my God.
Fire subject matter.
Yo, but I love her. I love, love. Not but, and. I love her truly. You know, I wish my mom would have gave me a younger sibling, like a little brother or a little sister, because I'd be adopting people like crazy.
You know, you say that until you get them. Yep.
How many? So you're not the youngest?
Who, me?
Yeah.
No.
No? No. Where do you fall in the line?
Well, my dad has other children outside of the union of him and my mom. So I was the oldest of the three they had together. And I'm all somewhere else, you know, with the others.
So, okay.
Yeah, they're a total of seven. Oh, wait, hold on. Yes, seven.
You know, I should have guessed that because you are a caretaker. You know. I think sometimes against your better judgment, you try not to, but you do, and you are quick to discipline people. Like, I mean, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you will, and I don't mean like in an authoritarian way. It's loving. It's with love. But I think you will rein folks in. Like, okay, we could play. But hey, okay. You know?
Yeah. But you know what that is? You know what that is too? And I have a better way of framing that, you know, because some people, I've heard mixed things over the years. So what I've boiled it down to is that people deserve to know upon entry what the rules are. You know what I mean? So that they don't fall into, like, because one size don't fit all, you know, and for anybody who's ever seen me in real life, I'm a woman of a substantial size. I'm a 6 foot so-and-so. So what I'm, and just one size doesn't fit all.
6 foot beautiful human being.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate that. But to keep me that way, to keep me a beautiful 6 foot human being, it's important that folks know the rules at the door, meaning you just can't treat me or do any kind of way. I just don't have that in me. So immediately, you know, and it's not a check. It's just an acquaintance, if you will, you know, like what, and I tell you immediately. So that way things don't have to foster within me. Try to fix this mic stand. It's deciding to do its own thing. Folks, so that they know that, you know, and just as I know, like I'm quick to ask folks, how do these rules apply to you? You know, like meaning there's a few things we don't do. You know, we're not disrespectful to folk, and we don't do a lot of whole lot of hollering and screaming and disrespectful things. We just don't do that. So
right.
And I've had a couple of people ask in ways that, you know, they didn't think they were asking, and I just informed them. I just feel like it's information.
What are they asking?
Well, it's an indirect ask, you know, through action. Sometimes they find themselves in a pickle, you know, but I'll take them to the side and say, look, you know, that's not cool. We just have to, we got to do better, you know, there. We got to do better, you know. And I'll try not to be exploitive about it, but it's, you know, depending on the circumstances, you know, I can customize my approach, you know.
Absolutely. So I want to give a shout out to Walt Taylor, whose birthday is tomorrow, who we love.
And hey,
Walt, you can give a call in later on when N'Dea Davenport calls in. Walt is a very big fan of Ms. Davenport. So, and it's his birthday weekend, so you know we got to do that. Shout out to Derek Muhammad and the Derek Muhammad Show. Derek is, everybody got to go check him out. If you're checking us out, check him out. You'll dig him.
High energy, good brother.
Yes. Now, you know what someone said to me, which I guess is it could be an insult and a compliment all at the same time. And probably for Derek, this is probably a compliment. But someone was watching when we were interviewed on his show, and I haven't seen that interview uploaded, Derek. So if you're going to upload it, let me know how I can find it. Or please just send me the link or something so I can post it. But someone said to me, yeah, it was a great show. I love his energy. He's a little too straight for me, though.
Straight?
Straight, heterosexual.
Oh my God. Listen, the world needs cisgender men, okay?
You know what I'm saying? It's so funny. People, this is one of the things that inspire me to continue on, because you never know what people are going to say. People are entertaining. You know, I love people. I love people.
Yes.
After I get over idiots, you know, them being idiots, I can look back and laugh at them later. Cause I think it's about, you know, maybe that's one of my problems. Everything is damn funny to me.
Well, no. Keep that laughter, because, you know, sometimes, you know, you'll find in this very limited life that we have, very, very limited, you know, we think, you know, 50 is old or 60 is old, but that's very limited compared to the rest of the time, because it will roll on. And laughter is key. You have to incorporate laughter in everything.
And let me just say, since you mentioned age again, I will not stop saying happy birthday to Pops until August is done. And Pops is watching and posting. Pops is supposed to be on the beach continually celebrating.
That's probably all he has is his phone out there on the beach. So
I know, right? Period.
And a mask.
Love you, Pops. Thank you so much, man. Enjoy your day, baby. Enjoy your day. Yeah. So I want to go now to, hopefully, let's see, let's make it work. A brief commercial message.
A barrier-breaking prosecutor with a love for grilling.
Question, I will repeat.
Roasting and music.
Nation under a groove. Getting down.
California Senator Kamala Harris has joined the race for the White House.
I am running for president of the United States, and I'm very excited about it. I'm very excited about it.
So who is she? Harris has a history of being the first.
Maybe the first to do many things, but make sure you're not the last.
In 2010, she was the first woman and person of African and South Asian descent to become California's Attorney General.
I decided to become a prosecutor because I believed that there were vulnerable and voiceless people who deserved to have a voice in that system.
And in 2016, she became the first Black senator from California.
So my question to you,
Harris serves on four Senate committees and is perhaps best known for her tough questions.
It makes me nervous.
Is that a no? Is that a yes?
Can I get to respond, please, ma'am?
No, sir. No.
She's moved to the left in recent years, but her political message remains broad, stressing unity and togetherness.
We are all in this together.
She has defended immigrants' rights, as well as public schools and Medicare for all. But her signature issue is criminal justice reform.
Crime is not a monolith. We cannot have a one-size-fits-all approach to criminal justice policy.
Critics on her left have called her record into question, arguing that she failed to embrace progressive reforms during her tenure as district attorney and California's attorney general. So what's her dynamic with President Trump? Harris has voted against more Trump administration nominees than most of her peers. She has called Trump's border wall
his vanity project,
and the government shutdown
crisis of leadership.
For now, Trump has said little about her. So what are her chances? Political strategists believe Harris may be better positioned to build coalitions than some of her party rivals.
This is our house!
A recent poll gave her an overwhelmingly favorable rating among Democrats. But as a relative newcomer to national politics, many voters may be waiting to hear more from Harris before making up their minds.
Now back to our show.
Kamala Harris. What say you?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And yeah, you know, I'm all with it. I'm for it. I'm here for it. How you doing, Miss Smith? Charlene Smith. Good morning, darling. Yeah, and quite frankly, we have this platform and we're going to use it in any way that we see fit. Any way that can help move progress. And yeah, so that's that.
Is that a question? Do we have to defend that? I'm trying to figure that out.
No. I'm just saying it because I said it.
I was just wondering because, I know that folks have mixed opinions. Let's just talk about it real fast, so we can get to some stuff. But, the reality is I'll just say my reality, that we know that any person that is doing anything out in the world, and I mean any person, take it a politician, anybody, is going to have both pros and cons connected to their existence. That only means that you've been doing things on the planet. You have been living your life in service. And if you're living your life in service, there are some pros and there are some cons with that, because in service means that you are entrenched in the people. And everybody's not going to love you, such as real life. Everybody don't like you, and that's okay, because, like, again, one size don't fit all. That's fine. But the reality is about the bigger picture, and meaning when you don't have your presence confused with the main event, which is get this country in order, which is get these people in order, which is killing this systemic age-old issue of equality and equity and so many other things we can think of. See, I wish people would spend the time drilling down on an agenda points and drilling down on what you'd like to see in the world as opposed to who. Because it's not about Kamala Harris and it's not about Biden and it's not about Trump individually. It is about the people of the United States. And the people of the United States are a beautiful cornucopia of a lot of things. And unfortunately, there's a certain population of folk that have run the United States that do not believe in liberty and justice for all. So when we get any candidate in office, if your agenda is not liberty, justice, and equity for all, then you need not be there. So I think that we need to boil down on the tenets of what they're doing and ask about the things that are hurting us as African Americans systemically and what their agenda is for it. We don't need to get into whether or not you like or dislike them as individuals or whatever they did in the course of their occupations that may not have been favorable, you know? But the idea is that she's there and doing it. Like, who wants to do the job? You? I didn't see anybody else jockeying for that position. All these folk that we have in direct conflict, whatever it is, and going to toss their vote. Because quite frankly, let's just be clear. If you are not voting for them, you are voting for Trump. Period. That's what you're doing. So go angry, go whatever it is, but use that anger, channel that anger in a space where you can mobilize people in the front lines of your communities. Meaning if you live in a community and you're not involved in the grassroots politics of that community, meaning from your council person on up, I don't know if you get a right to say, and even if you do, then get entrenched in that so that you can move other things along and see the agenda, the collective agenda that we need to have. So I'm really tired of the why do we got to get to the action items. And if these people are going to be actionable and they're going to include some of the things that we need to be able to break, because it's not, you know, because the system has to break completely for us to rehab it. You know, I don't want a rehabbed system with the same old stuff in it. You know, we've been singing soon and very soon for a long time, you know, and I'd like to see something different in my lifetime. But if not, I want the agenda to be set up for that.
Absolutely. Soon and very soon. That's true. That's true.
Listen, I just.
Castle in the sky.
Listen, you know what I mean? I'm tired of overcoming. I'm tired of doing a whole lot of things. You know, I'm looking for actionable items. We have enough resources and enough opinions. We ain't never short of opinions to get together a boilerplate agenda to present to anybody that's going to claim that they represent, you know, a population of folks that have been nameless and faceless for far too long. Now, you know the faces because you clearly distinguish, but nameless and faceless for far too long without a concrete agenda. And, you know, and there's nobody going to technically save us anyway, you know. So we really need to save ourselves. And how we do that is by demanding what we need to do. That's it. Collectively. I'm talking from economics on down. Claim it and let's organize and get it together. That's it. I don't know any other ways to do it at this point. I've looked at everything in my short span here. So what are we doing, people? What are we doing? You complaining? You part of the problem or you part of the solution? And if you don't like what's in front of you, then why aren't you there? You know, one thing they can say about crazy Kanye is he wanted to be there. You know, I just wish he sit his ass down so that we don't have the confusion about things right now. It's too important right now. Too important right now.
I've been looking at this situation with him, and he's having backdoor conversations with the current administration. He's working with them to cause distraction. And it's sad because he's being used. They're taking advantage of his mental state, his state of mind, his understanding of who he is and who we are and what who's sitting there. Okay.
You know what I think Kanye sees though? I think that we got narcissist meets narcissist there. But let me say this, what I think about Kanye. I think that Kanye is, quite frankly, enamored by the accessibility of the, because you got to think about it like this too. And I kind of thought this through a little bit. It is remarkable to some degree what 45 has done, because he went from nowhere to somewhere. You understand? And what I mean by that is that he is developing the myth that you have to have any political background, anything, to be the president of the United States. That's some feat in and of itself. So meaning somebody that was not a politician, somebody that was not a whole lot of things and still ain't, was able to get to the highest seat in the country. However that was. So I think that is what Kanye is enamored with, his accessibility to that seat. You know, so because quite frankly, it means that anybody can do it.
I don't know that that's true, because first of all, he was one of the more popular people in our what do you call it? Not the culture, but there's another word for it. I can't think of the word, but he was a reality TV show. Everybody knows the name. Quite frankly, because of all of the crooked deals that he's done, but people know of his father's wealth that was trickled down to him, right? And people think, oh, he's rich, he must know something about money. No, he knows how to lose money. His father gave him $1 million when $1 million was worth $500 million today. He lost that. Then he got into some seedy deals with some seedy bank and some seedy Russians and some gangsters, was able to get money, launder money. He's been doing nothing but crookedness. And I've watched video of people who voted for him, and they said, I mean, these people are really like lost. They're like, well, he made all that money, so if he could make money, he's going to show us how to make money. He ain't make no money. He stole. He cheated. He was given and gifted. So if somebody's going to, now my dad, as you know, has passed away, he's not going to gift me $500 million. He's not going to give me that start. And if he did and I lost it, I might be hard pressed to get that money back, or like have, because I'm not going to launder, steal, and cheat and do all of that slippery, slimery, conniving crap that he's done in order to be where he is. And the people that believe in him, the people who are still his staunch supporters, are either uneducated or lower educated white folks. And
what I'm thinking about, though, is the reason why Kanye is connected.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
In terms of how he gets connected, what he's enamored with behind President Trump. And right. I don't believe just because you're black, you have to vote Democrat. See, I'm not a party pusher at all. What I am is I'm an agenda person. You know, I'd like to know what your beliefs are and where you think that you can lead this country, you know. And do you even see this country, you know? Because sometimes I don't think Donald, when he was here on the streets in New York, I don't think that he saw this country. I think he is very marginalized. As president, you can't be marginalized anymore. Once upon a time, marginalized presidents, you know, that's all we had, except for Kennedy and, you know, scatter a few others. Kennedy was the first in my lifetime. Oh, did I just say that? Yeah, in my lifetime that was felt like more in touch with the people, was not marginalized. Although his wealth made him marginalized, he, in fact, his views were not marginalized. So when you think about Kanye, I just think that he's impressed with the idea that somebody that came from, when I say nothing, meaning no political background, no public opinion outside of the Central Park Five, you know, for the people situation, where he took full page ads to defame and to punish and to said some really really things in these articles that ended up not being true once again. But we're all used to him not being telling the truth now. the fact that he paid for all this at a certain time when this trial was going on was ridiculous for him to even, you know, he knew what he was talking about. Like now, ain't nothing changed. He just knows he knows what he's talking about. Ain't talking about shit, really, you know.
And due to that New York incident and so many other things that he has said and done, has been sued for and has paid out so that this doesn't get publicized and this and that. And, you know, especially though, the Central Park Five, you would think Kanye, since we want to talk about Kanye being woke, would be woke on that. I mean, like, come on, man, this dude is not
woke.
No, I'm not saying that he's woke. I'm just saying that I don't think he's woke. I think he's quite sleepy. And somebody should put him down, give him a change his pamper, give him a bottle, and let him go to sleep. Rock-a-bye baby. Yeah, I said it.
Wait. Hold on. First of all, I think that he's an incredible mind. Because
I think a talented mind.
Yes, talented mind. I don't want to rip anything from him, with the exception of that you can see that there's some imbalance there. But that may not be anything that's like, with tons of people have imbalances. How that affects you in your movement, I don't know if he's always as stabilized as we'd like to believe Brother Kanye is. I just think that. I think that he, and I don't want to, you know, and I'm not down for human being reeled in. But I think he's in waters that he has that can drown him, you know. And I think that he's very impulsive. I think that he is led by an agenda, which is in his head, you know, because he'll flip on anybody, you know. And to me, flipping on folks is unstable, you know. It just is. When you flip, when you find yourself flipping a lot, that just means you need to be stabilized. However they're doing it.
And that's what I mean by giving a bottle, pampered, and put to bed.
Okay.
That's what I mean by that.
Okay.
Stabilized.
Yeah. Talking about baby means something else.
No. I am not calling for that. Okay. No. Damn, okay. You're such a gangster.
No, listen, that's what it when you listen.
No. But you don't give him a bottle.
Listen.
That's not what I'm saying. People, okay. What I'm saying is, for example, when there have been certain public episodes, you know, like where was his people to say, hey, you know, where are his loved ones is what I'm saying.
So, what you see them dragging, getting dragged, because when a man's gonna do something, a man's gonna do it. When he's
I understand that. But sometimes, you know, and you let a brother do what a brother gotta do, but you gotta rein him in. You ever see that movie Coming to America with Eddie Murphy? Remember
classic.
What's his name? James Earl Jones was the king, right? Yes. And Madge Sinclair was the queen.
Yes.
So, but James Earl Jones was clearly in charge as the king, and he did not want his son to be married to that girl in Queens. Yes. And then there's a scene where they're sitting in the back of their limo and they're going back to Africa after he told the girl, nobody wants you, get away, you're trash, my son is, you know, a prince, right? Basically, right. He didn't say that, but I'm paraphrasing. Right. And, you know, the queen is mad now, you know.
Right.
She done showed the lower part of his kingdom, you know, his king side, right? Whatever. So he says, well, you're still mad? What am I supposed to do? It is tradition. Who am I to change it? She said, I thought you were the king. And with that, at the end of the movie, the prince is marrying the girl from Queens. We know how to rein a man in when it's necessary. And right now, it's necessary. Not that it, well,
Mental illness is a different beast. It's a different beast.
That's true. That's true. And even for that, if you have a loved one with an illness, you know, you do the best that you can to take care of them, you know, and on a stage that grand, on a stage, you...
Let me say this too, and I just want to clarify my statement there. Mental illness in most cases can be stabilized. You know, I think that my personal beliefs are that we all are to not be what I consider fine-tuned in areas when you know you have things that weigh on you, or maybe not. You know, we all in this lifetime need to be talking to somebody professional, somebody that is equipped to manage these emotional anxieties and things going on, particularly right now. So when you don't do that, you run the risk of things becoming attached to your psyche and your well-being that may not serve you. You know, when, and I'll just take like things like depression and anxiety. There is help for depression. There's talk therapy. There's all kinds of things going on for depression and up to and including sometimes medication to stabilize. And there's nothing wrong with that because you don't want to find yourself slipping in a space that, you know, or maybe, and you may not even realize it. Maybe sometimes your folk can say to you that notice a difference. Hey, maybe you need to sit down and talk with somebody, you know, because it helps. It does help. That is proven. That's not an arguing point. It's just mental illness is real. And when you don't stabilize it or you don't consider the help that's out there, you know, it can be detrimental to your survival here. You know, we want everybody well and healthy. We want everybody making decisions that that serve them. But I'm a strong advocate for mental health. I don't care what it takes. Sit down with somebody, do some other kind of therapy. There are all kinds of therapy out there that's like amazing, you know, that can help get you in a grounded state of mind and well-being. Because we are in a serious time right now. And if you were struggling before, I know you are struggling now. And, you know, self-medicating is not the answer for it. You know, you have to really, really seek help and understand it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And thank you for that. And check in on your people. So right now we're going to switch lanes. We're going to turn lanes right quick. And we're going to prepare for our very, very special guest today. N'Dea Davenport, right? I mean, yeah. Like who the Brand New Heavies. Matter of fact, what I'm gonna do right now, before she calls in, I'm gonna play the video to my favorite Brand New Heavy song, if I can get it, if I can get it up.
You know, and, true as trees are tall and autumn leaves do fall, and sometimes it rains in paradise, and even the warmest heart can turn to ice. Lyrics, let's go, let's go.
Let's do it. Let's do it. Thank you. Been a magic. Yeah, that song is just too fierce. I can't even imagine that's not even the point. But what I will say is that not only is she an awesome singer, but she is also a songwriter, extremely talented songwriter who's collaborated with some amazing people. As a matter of fact, just early this morning, I was sent some tracks that some music that she collaborated with Louis Vega and some other amazing people for some boss freaking house music and other types of music. They call it acid jazz. And let me tell you, man, she's a dancer, and I've also been informed, and I don't know if she wants to talk about this, but she's a DJ as well.
Ooh, okay.
I mean, like, What don't she do? What don't you do, right? I'm just saying, neo soul. She was one of the originators of that sound. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you think about it, with the Brand New Heavies, that whole era, man, in the beginning and even now, you know. And I just found out. You see, I get animated when I get excited. Obviously, I'm excited. I just found out that she's Grammy nominated. Now, that don't happen every day to anybody. Matter of fact, everybody, you know what I'm saying? I'm just very, very excited about the opportunity to have this legendary, amazing artist on the show with us today, Rezzy.
Yo, me too, Jay. You know, it's I remember, first of all, the Brand New Heavies and N'Dea Davenport. have gotten me through. I remember that, I must have worn the trenches out of that CD around a very significant time in my life growing up, having a good time and just, you know, and I've always been a lyric girl and I've always loved the sound of N'Dea Davenport, wondering where the hell she is and what she's doing. And, you know, because she made such an invaluable contribution to my jam, you know, my personal jam. And I know that, you know, I used to get together with friends, shout out to Lois, Liani, and we'd get together and just play that over and, oh, just leave it on tilt. There's so many CDs, and I say CDs because that, you know, that was what was released at that time, that we just let play, that one of them, just back, from front to back.
That's what's up. So with that and without any further ado, and I don't know whether or not you saw my text, but have your phone handy just in case, okay? But we're going to bring on to the show right now to delight your eardrums with, you want to know where she is, where she's been? She's right here in the basement having brunch with JaVonne and Terez. Everybody, N'Dea Davenport.
Hello.
Hey. Okay, so I want to make sure that you can hear us and that we can hear you. Can you hear?
Perfect. Can you hear me?
I can hear you fine. Can you hear Terez?
Okay, you guys are a little choppy. You guys are a little choppy, but I think we can get through.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Excellent.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good afternoon. Where have you been? We miss you.
Yes, we miss you.
I figured that was a question of the decade in relation to me. My goodness, you know, life is such a propelling thing. You know, there's always a creativity that I enjoy doing. And there's also the experience of living life that has been taking a priority with me as well, getting creative in other aspirations that, you know, I've been putting off for a long time. So, but here I am, full in effect.
Yes.
That's what's up.
Yes. You know, that question, N'Dea, is for me because, I'm grateful to have the opportunity to say, we miss you, and whatever you are doing, we are here for it. Do you understand? We're here for it.
Thank you very much. I think, you know, some of us that express our art, you know, some people really are inspired by staying in the studio 24 hours a day, continuously pumping out tracks or being creative, whatever their art is. I'm one of those people, you know, I like to get out and see and continuously see and express with travel, you know, to experience life, to be amongst different people, just to have a really well-rounded life. And so it takes a lot of time. There's been a lot of unexpected things to happen along the course. There's been a lot of things and other achievements that are unexpected. So I just think it's a really full life, and I'm one of those people that really likes to express that. Traveling, living in foreign countries, learning different languages, you know, those are all of those things that really like help to balance things for me. Continuing to collaborate with people in different parts of the world, you know, and not just getting very just so in one area of, or necessarily regionally, you know, I just like to express living in the best way that I know how.
Nice.
So you said other parts of the world. I always associate you with the UK in particular. Am I off kilter with that, or is that on point?
No, you're not off kilter with it. You know, it's one of those things sometimes, I guess, when you are adopted by a community or area, it's a little bit hard for them sometimes. They won't completely let you go, However, physically, I sort of went the absolute opposite direction. I'm spending a lot of time in Asia these days. I still have a lot of affiliation. As I said, you know, England won't really let me go. I still do a lot of different projects with producer DJs, different collaborations, wherever that might be. It could be France, it could be UK, but definitely I still have my root is some rootings in the UK, but I am spending more time in Asia these days.
Nice, nice. Asia has a good community, parts of different. I have a few artist friends that have made home in Asia, both athletes and performing artists.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, I mean, I think there's, depending on what your take is on your life or how you want to direct it, I suppose, or just experience something else. You know, I wouldn't say that foreign countries are for everyone. You know, you're not going to have a same United States experience. You know, and you shouldn't go there. I think if you do make a decision about living outside the United States, I think, you know, there's a lot of things you have to consider that it's uncomparable sometimes when you compare like United States, and we don't really know exactly like, you know, how things are going to shape and form in the U.S. at this point. But, you know, but you have to keep an open mind, I think, when you're traveling or living away from here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So of all the things that you've been doing, let's take it back for a minute. Let's go back a few years. What were some of the most exciting things that you've accomplished? Because you've accomplished so much over your career that I don't want to pigeonhole one thing, but what were some of the most exciting things that you've accomplished?
I think one of the really exciting things for me is playing at Wembley Stadium, where there's, you know, I think it's a capacity of somewhere 70,000 to maybe 90,000 people. Don't quote me on that, but it's definitely a good 70,000. And performing, and actually for the first time, I actually understood what world leaders go through or what they experience, because when you're speaking to a sea of people and they're actually responding and you're just basically guiding them on, like, you know, doing something collectively together in that one room or that one space, you know, something kind of really clicked, you know, internally that gave me a specific boost to just visualize that and see that people can kind of work on one accord. That was an amazing moment for me. I think the first time I ever left the United States, I was, you know, I guess an ingenue, musical ingenue, and I had the opportunity to work with Al Jarreau. Wow. And years ago, just out of college, and I'm embarrassed to say I wasn't even as familiar with Al's work. But leaving the United States kind of like really a specific tone in my head. And I guess I just kept traveling ever since, you know, that first step away outside of the United States. And that my first city was Paris. So I always have like a very special love for France and for Paris as well, you know.
Wow.
Nice. Tell us something, and for artists that are from the U.S. that go abroad to work, what in your first, like you said, you landed in Paris first, was that, or was that UK?
Yeah, that was my first outside experience of the U.S. was Paris. And I've come to see so many different people that go to other countries to expound on their work. A lot of times there's a lot of admiration, especially for people in soul music, funk music, black music. You know, there's such a great admiration and a loyalty fan base that you and a choir, I would believe. And not to abandon U.S. fans or anything like that. I just think that, you know, there is a certain level of loyalty that that is established for some reason, whereas maybe in the States it's a little more, we have so much music that comes every other day, every week, you know, maybe it's a little more disposable. But at the same time, I do notice that people's response is very clear, it's very passionate, and people love music and they respond to it. So, I mean, there's just a lot of opportunities for artists. There's a lot of us do, and in history, even from jazz greats down, you know, they have gone and enjoyed the fruits of what outside of American fan bases are like. You know, it's a pretty phenomenal thing. I mean, but it's definitely a historical thing. So it's nothing new in my case, or what could be the future someone else's. You know.
Yeah.
Wow. Right. Did the band do anything separate? Are they still performing separate from you? Are you still together? Like, what's going on with the Brand New Heavies?
Right. I know that's probably in the second number one question. Second question that would be like high on the scale about what's the situation with the band. You know, that's such an onion of a question. And I want to be honest with you, and I know many people have tried to figure out what's going on. I should take it back a little bit, whereas initially when we met years ago, I was a solo recording artist on the label at the time in Los Angeles, Delicious Vinyl Records. They were licensed to Delicious Vinyl Records, all with association with labels in England called Acid Jazz, which obviously was independent music label, just like Talking Loud labels were, like, definitely promoting Black music, soul music, not only Black music, but it just had a very interesting tone attached with it. So when we met, we combined forces. It really came out of nowhere, the reception that that we were getting, especially bringing soul music back to, and live instrumentation back to, the originators of the genre here in the States. And people basically just went for it so quickly. We didn't really have a chance to digest anything. We really just were jumping from country to country, touring for forever, what it seemed, you know, very few breaks. And it just came a time, I think, sometimes when young people are not as prepared, or maybe the mentorship is not there. You know, sometimes other entities kind of get in the way, and I think problems started to arise. We obviously, as our successes started building, you know, I actually joined officially with the group as aside from two different entities. As time went on, it became a lot more challenging, I suppose, to work with the band, especially you know, eventually I did go on and move there, but I was commuting from California to England all the time. It was just never any rest. And, you know, there's a lot of, started to being a bit of dissension as bands. It happens so many times. You can ask so many band members. It gets very challenging, I think, with different personalities, different ideas, the direction of where you'd like your, you know, where the band should go. But I think what's really important is trust, you know, and having a moral system or value system. And if you are a team, you know, you have got to always look out for those other team members. And it gets really, really challenging also being, you know, it can kind of get into a situation where you're a bit outnumbered. Not that that has any less value on your stance or your position or your being able to contribute, you know, creatively. However, you know, it gets to a certain point where I think it just can get to a certain point where things can get a little out of balance. Mm. And it did not work well in my favor, even though I knew the fans always wanted to see and hear us. They almost didn't want to let us go. And it was very difficult, I think, to get their understanding without telling the whole stories of why it wasn't in my best interest to continue with the band. Now, obviously, the band has to go on and do what they have to do. There's been certain changes in the lineup with certain other conflicts that are obviously going on within the entities of the band. So there are other female vocalists that were asked to come in, and definitely after my departure, some people have come, some people have stayed a little longer than others, but you know, if you notice, there are different artists that they work with, which they should continue with their work. You know, however, it's unfortunate that I'm not actually an official member. I do my own projects. They do what they do. However, in order to appease the fans this time, I co-wrote a track that's for their most recent album. There's a different vocalist I think they have on some songs. I'm not really clear how they're doing everything. However, I did agree to be a contributor. And a lot of that had to do with a great producer, friend, Mark Ronson, that loves the band and has supported my work and things like that for a very long time. And sort of like convinced me to collaborate on a song that he actually did it's a remake of a Kendrick Lamar song, If These Walls Could Talk. Mm. Because Mark was involved, of course I wanted to be involved. I love collaborating. He's, you know, with him. He sends out the track. I write, curate vocals, completely kind of transform the song of what it was. And that was one of the collaborations that I just as far as just as a contributor. And that was one of the first times that I haven't actually toured with the band that of songs that I've worked on. But, you know, we're in a different age now where we can be a part of things and not be a part of them at the same time. But a lot of it has to do with them continuing on with other vocalists. I guess it does make some of the fans happy. Some of them are not so happy about it. But, you know, there's a lot of questionable past history between me and the guys. And right now, I think it's just best that we stay in our own separate entities and engage wherever it's appropriate. And that's pretty much the best way, I guess, I can answer, you know, what's going on with me and the band at this time.
Well, I'd like to, can I say some things to you? I'd like to say to that, you sound like the consummate professional in everything that you've explained. Thank you for that. You know, I was a diehard Brand New Heavies fan. Sorry to hear that there were differences that that separated the group, but happy to hear that you still contribute to their jam, you know, in any ways that you see fit, or that you can still have your voice and or pin talent out there. You know, Brand New Heavies for me personally, and I'm grateful at the opportunity to be able to tell you how you impacted a life, you know, indirectly. I'll tell you, there were three bands that, you know, and what I call boutique bands, because they weren't the big blown out 90 piece orchestras, but they were like the three top bands in my development that I gravitated toward. The boutique ones were Brand New Heavies, The Culture Club, and Sweetback, you know, featuring Sade. So, you guys rocked, and you know, and I would love, you know, and you know, granted, I don't make, but from a huge fan perspective, I would love to see anything that you are doing, and want to help promote it, whatever it is that you're doing, and also at the same time, I'm low key hoping that, you know, there's a reunion of sorts where you guys get to get together and slam us with some of your old classics. Because I'll tell you something, were you writing a lot of the stuff on those albums back then?
Yes. Yes. And I think that's the whole thing too. When you're even a woman or a musician in this business, especially at that point, I think, because this is like early 90s, I don't think women actually got all the recognition, especially in Black music, Black production. Women that are, you know, women that are producing, that were producing music, women that were writing music, I think people got really conditioned into, and no disrespect, obviously, to the great singers and the vocalists of the world that, you know, have the privilege or the honor of being given great songs that make huge hits. However, I don't think there was exactly, especially during that period of time, you know, early 90s, late 80s, that particular thing, where artists as females were really given a lot of focus on their writing abilities, their curation of these live shows or putting these shows together, which was a lot of my responsibilities with the Brand New Heavies, you know, our set list, you know, how we're, our production of the direction of how our songs are, the moods, the tones of the colors, the production of how all of that kind of fits together and makes the glue that is a specific sound. There, even the songwriters that came before me and artists that came before me, like the Karen Wheelers of the world, from yeah. Soul to Soul, you know, I mean, no one ever really realized that Karen wrote those songs, you know, Keep On Moving, and you know, it's a lot that I just feel that there's certain little missing parts. You know, I did hear in my introduction as well, you know, with you know, even affiliating us or considering we're the pioneers of a certain sound at that time, opening the door for neo soul.
Absolutely.
You know, which gave them and gives them the opportunities especially as young women, to be able to have more freedom in order for their projects. I mean, I wouldn't consider Alicia Keys necessarily neo soul. However, but I think that it really, by us consistently persisting to be heard and for even in interviews, for people to understand our contributions, which our contributions are so many, and at the same time, they may be slightly overlooked. I do know as well, even someone, I don't know her personally, but someone even like a different genre of soul music, but like a Angela Wimbush. Mm-hmm. Wimbush?
Yes.
That has been producing, you know, producing the Isley Brothers, producing all types of things. We didn't know that.
Right.
I don't think when we were growing up, and we didn't assume that women were on the backbones of a lot of these projects. But now we're in a different age where it's okay to express yourself. It's okay to, you know, write, to produce. I mean, when I was working on my solo record, it was such a challenge, not so much by my record label, not so much by, you know, some of the fans, but some of my male counterparts that were engineers that I would be hiring to help just to complete the work. And I think, you know, sometimes, again, there are a lot of different issues within our business. Whereas, you know, there can be dissension, and maybe because, oh, you have the freedom, I don't have the freedom, I'm doing this. And it's like, well, you know, when you manifest, when you work hard and you manifest, and then you start showing the, you know, putting your money where your mouth is, it's like, well, you got receipts. I have receipts. I have just the opportunity to be here just like everyone else. And yes, it was a struggle even during, with the independence of working on a solo record, which everybody doesn't get to have free reign and do what they want to do. And that was a new method, you know? So that's why I give the door open for the Erykah Badus, the Alicia Keys, and the N'Dea Irees to just create. And that's all. No one wants to be, I think, you know, secondary to anyone. We just want the same sort of respect and the, you know, the enjoyment of our works to be equally expressed and shared. And, you know, we could go on about that for
yeah, a while. But also to get credit for the work that you've done, you know, I mean, you wrote those songs, Angela Wimbush, you know, now later on realizing that the work that she did with Renee and Angela, she wrote most of those songs and produced a lot of that stuff. And when she wanted credit, they fired her. You know, like, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. But that's one of the reasons why we do this show, is that we want to give you your flowers now, because when people pass on, that's when you learn all of the things that they did, you know, the little details and the big details. And you know, you deserve so much more credit than you get. People think Brand New Heavies, they think Brand New Heavies, you know, and sometimes, you know, if you say N'Dea Davenport, they're like, oh yeah, she used to sing with the Brand New Heavies. But there was so much more to that. There's so much more to you. And before we go any further, what I'd like to do, if it's okay with you, is I'd like to play These Walls, because I was sent that song, and it is a beautiful song. Who was singing on, who sang the lead on this song?
Okay, now this is where it's questionable, because after I sent in you know, my reworks of this song, because I think the band also did another version of it with their singer, their current singer. I know she does a lot of the live work. I can't remember her name, but I've seen, like, I've heard the vocals, or I saw a video or something. So depending on which version you got, the original version is me. That's all of my harmonies that were created. And, you know, you remember how the original, If These Walls Could Talk,
right?
Those are all of my, that's all my new arrangement, everything of the vocals, the lyrics, you know,
right,
arrangement, melody. So I, depending on what you got, let's hear it, and then I'll let you know if it's me or if it's her.
Okay, all right, let's do it. This is the Brand New Heavies, and you're listening to WJBR Internet Radio, Brunch in the Basement with JaVonne and Terez.
Feeling secrets and surprises, beautiful heart you.
Shout out to the birthday girl, say hey, say hey. Oh. Everyone deserves a night to play, she plays.
Oh, you don't know if they love that day, would everybody wanna have
around you. I know you know that through life's every strain or joy that made you run from most unpleasant spaces.
She just
won
the close for eyes and sway. She sways. Everyone deserves a night to play.
I hope that was you because I love it.
It was me. Yeah, that's all me.
Yes, I thought that was, they must have got a sound alike, like that sound just like you. And I'm like, yo, I don't know who that is, but I'm loving it. I'm loving it.
You know what? This is the crazy thing, you know, about, like I said, the differences within the band. You know, these are the discrepancies. It's like the clarity, and it's almost like having someone that wants you to be, it's like a bad marriage, or you want them for certain reasons, and then just so the fans won't really know what's going on, but they know the name. It's a little bit confusing. It's a little unfair to the fans. Or, yeah. You know, even if you're expecting that I'm going to be there and you don't share that with the fans, it's a little unfortunate. I mean, I don't work like that, you know, and it started kind of being a problem. And this is another one of those problems. You don't know who it is, but you know it's Brand New Heavy. So you're going to pay, oh, it's Brand New Heavy, so I'm going to support it. What is it or not? You know, you don't utilize the people that, what is it? You don't bite the hand that feeds you. I don't think you should do that.
Absolutely.
No, you should.
Let me just say this. There is a gentleman who is a great fan of our show. He's also a DJ. He plays your music all the time. His name is DJ Walt Taylor. And today, tomorrow is his birthday, so he's celebrating his birthday weekend. And when he found out that you were going to be on the show, he went crazy. He's delighted. And if it's okay with you, he's called in and would like to say hello to you. Is that cool with you?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, Walter on the air. Say hello to Ms. Davenport.
Oh, my goodness. Let me try to get my heart to stop beating so fast right now.
Oh, lovely.
It is such a pleasure to hear your voice live on the other end of the phone with me. Oh, my
fantastic.
Goodness.
Well, the pleasure to meet you. Happy birthday.
Well, I definitely do appreciate that, and I will definitely be blasting this clip out that N'Dea Davenport said, oh, my goodness, I can't even get it out. She said happy birthday to me, but you know, I really am a super fan of yours. I thank you so much for the shout. And I know the show is you know, you got a lot more to do with the two queens on the other end, and I won't take up much time. But thank you so much for all that you have done with music. I appreciate you. I love your creativity, and I just love you. I'm in love with you, okay? And my wife knows it, so she, you know, she's cool with it. She said, yeah, I know you're in love with her, but you ain't never gonna see her anyway, though.
No, I really appreciate that. You know, it's just hearing even like, you know, just that my work is not going in vain. You know, that gives me all the support to like keep on and continuing to be creative and create different things and be inspired for that. So I really, really value, you know, your appreciation for what I've attempted to do. And thank you to your wife too, you know, for allowing you to be able to talk to me.
Well, she's in the recording studio right now. She's recording with her group at the church, and so she knew was going on today because she knew about it last night. So I said, well, you know, I'm gonna be on the phone with me. I can't even continue to get your name out correctly because I'm so giddy right now. So I apologize. I apologize to Rez and Javonne, you know, but thank you so much for you two letting me get on with her. And wishing me a happy birthday. I will be 62 tomorrow, and I'm just feeling great and blessed and happy to be alive.
Oh, fantastic. You're just getting going. It's starting to get real interesting now, I think.
That's right. So thank you so much again. And you, and look, you. Never stop. You never stop either, okay?
Thank you.
God bless. All right.
Yeah, all right. You all be safe.
Thank you, Walt.
You'll do.
Bye.
Thank you, Javonne.
You're welcome, baby. Bye-bye.
Beautiful spirit. Walt Taylor is DJ Walt Taylor, and he has his own site that he does our music on, and he's always lifting artists. And you know, N'Dea, if you ever had the question whether or not you were loved and missed, please don't. And allow us to say that, you know, for the true music aficionados like Walt and ourselves, we know who you are, with and without the Brand New Heavies, and we just want to know what you're doing so that we can support it, whatever N'Dea Davenport chooses to do. I'd be lying if I said we would miss the entire group together. But you know, that can't happen, and I'm gonna leave the light on for that possibility, maybe at a big reunion show where, you know, we have the Culture Club and we have Day and we have Brand New Heavies. That would be like my dream show, you know, all of those acts on one bill, the original players, from Stewart to whoever that's gonna get on. But whatever you want to do, you know, we're here for it. And you're right, you were in the days of the 90s, you know, in the liner notes. So folks know what was happening. Whether I'm just glad that you were there doing what you were doing, because the sound of Brand New Heavies outside of the instrumentation, I'm sure that was cultivated towards your voice. I want to ask you about Deep Water. Did you write that?
Well, I'm sorry, which song? You broke up a little. About which song?
Deep Water.
Deep Water, she said.
Deep Water. Oh, no, that's Mesa. That's Incognito.
Yeah.
Deep Water.
Yes.
That's a song. I just heard that yesterday, and I'm really starting to, like, you know, with everything going on, certain songs really resonate with you. And no, that's, and also another colleague in comrade of mine, Mesa Lee, she's a part of Incognito.
Right.
Correct. Thank you, Wanda T. Yes, you're absolutely right.
But similar though, probably could get a little confusing or affiliated, because Mesa was living in the UK and she's an American singer as well. So she was also there at that time when I was there, but I believe, yeah.
You know, I got mixed up. It got mixed up because there are two in my, and right now in my CD, my iPod, both you and Mesa are blended into so many of the different play groups. So yeah, it's mixed in my mind, but not mixed in my heart. Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
So
I got you.
So you've been doing some new, more recent collaborations, right? With I mentioned Louis Vega, and there was a Grammy nomination.
Yes. I was just so floored by it was such a phenomenal how Louis just went down the line and chose and selected so many great voices of culture and of our culture that resonate right now. It was just special to be invited with all those great vocalists and to be nominated and find out, wow, okay, we got a Grammy Electronic Best Dance Album, Electronic Album. That's definitely the direction that I have always aspired to, because I like to keep creating and cultivating different evolutions of what applies to me and what I like to do in the present and in the future. You know, I've always really liked the presentations that Louis does. I mean, he just reaches such a vast audience of people. And I would have to say, unofficially, just for me, I would just call him like the Duke of music and dance, of movement, you know? Mm. He's like a Duke. And to have the honor this time, a lot of times I have to work usually because of pretty much I've been on a remote working thing for a very long time going, you know, embracing the 21st century. So a lot of times when people ask me to do collaborations, they'll send me a track, I'll like take it to the next degree, you know, writing it or arranging or coming up with melody ideas. And then just the singing part is the easy part. So it's just fortunate that I actually can apply the vocals to like the ideas or the blueprint to to help to glue whatever the track is. Louis and I started out that way, but we ended up, thankfully, I happened to be in the tri-state area. We got to work out and work together. And I think, again, you know, even someone as talented as he is, I think because of the mask of the name of the Brand New Heavies, he was not even aware of my depth of arrangement. And it was such a pleasure for him to see what I do face to face, to see what he does face to face. And by the time we completed the track, he puts another magic on it, and it just went to another level. I just appreciate himself. His wife is also an amazing artist, DJ, and we've become family now. And those are the greatest things about collaboration. You know, you gain another friend. You're either going to gain one or you're going to lose one, depending on the experience. But I've been really fortunate that a lot of the people that I work with, we actually have some level of a personal relationship, or we've developed that on you know, to some degrees. And that's also the exciting thing that continues, that keeps me motivated to keep working. You know, there are new projects that I am working on. There's one that I've been holding in the can for quite a while, but we let it out live every now and then. And it's a project, it was a futurist project, but as the 21st century continues to step forward, you know, we're finding that when we initiated working on within a 21st century capacity, meaning utilizing digital instrumentation to the best that you can, but still not forgetting about the traditional live instrumentation, so a live bass, you know, a live drum kit, but mashing up those two things. And that project it's a duo bass, and as well being in bands with so many people, I realized that, you know, I realized that the mode of the future is to downsize and to utilize the talent of in a small unit, to utilize it to such a degree that you really can wipe out all the middlemen. I felt like it was going to come to this point, and how music is going to have to make adjustments, how it's going to have to change, you know, downsizing with your traveling team, or all these things like that, or things that have been on my mind for a while. I developed a project with my partner it's an electronic project called Selectric. And it links itself to working on, and how it did start, which was also through an internet connection where people now can speak to each other from wherever they are.
Did we lose her? Okay. You know how the internet goes, folks. Sometimes we get a little glitchy. And we will be right back. So in the meantime, if you can still hear me, somebody give me a note in the chat. Shout out to Wanda T. We see you. Thank you. Another producer on the show hanging out with us today. If you can still hear me, let me know. They look to be a little frozen on the screen, so I'm not sure, but I still see the counter running. So just want to know if anyone in YouTube land can hear me. Okay, I can be heard. Wonderful, wonderful. Okay. So, you know, we're listening, if you just tuned in, you're listening live to N'Dea Davenport, formerly of the Brand New Heavies, the face, the voice of the Brand New Heavies. The original face and voice of the Brand New Heavies, I should say. And she's been here with us rocking. And just want to let everybody know that she's with us and giving us some of the backstory and where she's been. And fun fact, you know, and for those of you who don't know, the fun fact is that she wrote a lot of their stuff. So some of that stuff that you've been hearing, that loving, quite like myself, you know, it was N'Dea writing this stuff, you know, and she made some really poignant points about how women weren't given their due. Now, we're not surprised at all about the sexism in the music industry and various others that we are now tearing apart at the frame, which is good, you know. But what it meant was that a lot of the artists didn't get their recognition, particularly female artists, didn't get their recognition for producing and arranging and doing all the things that they do behind the scenes to make sure that we get what we need as fans of the music. So, you know, brand New Heavies, and, you know, now I'm inclined to say featuring N'Dea Davenport was an amazing group. And they are still both doing things, but separately now. And don't get it twisted, you know, I'm sure N'Dea is still getting her publishing and things that connected her to that sound. And as she said, that it still resonates with a lot of the fans. And, you know, she's still the consummate businesswoman and making sure that, you know, if there's something that she sees fit to lend her chops to, she will. And, you know, and that's sometimes how you got to do business, you know. And I'd be a liar if I sat here and didn't say it would be my personal fan fave to see them all together performing, because it was nothing like a Brand New Heavies featuring N'Dea Davenport sound. Nothing. You know, I remember seeing them, I believe it was in DC. And amazeballs. I think it was a park, in fact. I don't remember the year. You know, certain parts of this is sketchy, but I was in DC, I remember. I think it may have been Rock Creek, if I'm not mistaken. But went there and, you know, they were performing live. And live, she's amazing. She's a ball of fire live. And, you know.
Hey, I just want to check and see if we still have access to Ms. Davenport. Are you still there? Oh, she dropped a call. So, oh, wait, I think she just called back in. Hello, can you hear us? Ms. Davenport?
This is the internet, the people.
Yeah, it's the internet issue here. Let me see. Let's see.
While you're doing your magic on that, NJ, I was just repeating some of the things that she shared with us. And, you know, to have an opportunity to speak to an N'Dea Davenport is a luxury, because, you know, there are a lot of front women on some of these bands that made historic. You know, Brand New Heavies did cement their way in featuring N'Dea Davenport. And we definitely miss her sound with the Brand New Heavies, but also she's got her own sound that she's contributing to with Little Louis Vega. And, you know, we love Little Louis Vega and Kevin Hedge and all the rest of those pioneers. Basil, DJ Basil, another one, and another great. Just all those DJ Beloved, you know, another great. There's so many great producers out that grab and continue to evolve their sound and their footprint in musical, in our musical history, both digitally and live. She mentioned something about live instrumentation, which I'm a huge fan of. And I don't know what this world is going to be in terms of public venues and things like that, but I imagine smaller venues will once again prevail because the bigger venues have been chopped up by Live Nation and other corporations that have
Hold on one second. I'm sorry. Ms. Davenport, can you hear us? Hello? Okay, looks like she hung up again, I think. Jeez, what happened? Okay, go ahead, Rez. Sorry.
Oh, you know, just getting it back and making sure that, you know, we do give the shout out and we do give the instruments an opportunity to come back. You know, everything can't be done by a computer, and certainly you don't get the passion of a drummer in computer. You don't get all those you don't get the passionate strokes of the bass from a computer. You know, you don't get to change your mind, you know, once you have something programmed and go a different direction, you know. So those are things, you know, that, and it doesn't translate the same live, you know. You're going to have to come back to that live performance. And, you know, when you have an opportunity to see acts like the Brand New Heavies and featuring N'Dea Davenport, or any live, you know, like, or Sweetback featuring Sade, you know, Jill Scott with her live performance, you know, any of those artists that developed out of the 90s, early 2000s, doing live performances are amazing. And she mentioned N'Dea Avery, another amazing vocalist that hold, you just, yeah, you're right, Wanda, you can't improvise when you use computer. You know, you can't change the melody and the mix of things when you're using.
You are now in the host queue.
So I'm sure JaVonne is doing her damnedest to work out all the kinks.
Yes, yes. Okay. Can y'all hear me now? Because I can hear y'all.
Hold on, but we do appreciate you. You're speaking to Loretta, another fan listener, the silent partner of the show.
Oh, great. That's fine. Can you hear me? Yeah. I can hear me though, Loretta.
Yes, I can. I'm also calling in on the I'm listening in, I should say, on the phone.
I can hear you both.
Okay, that's fine.
Can y'all hear me?
Yeah. Hang up. I called you on another line to try
you can't
to
hear me?
Try to track you guys down. So I'm gonna hang up on this other line, but
no,
I just wanna make sure you're there, okay? Yeah. So what's going on is both of the phone lines
unmuted.
We can hear each other, but we're not hearing.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, we hear you.
All right, there we go. So we're back on. We're back on. I apologize for that. It's the internet. Rezzy, can you speak a little bit so we can ensure that everyone can hear you as well?
Test 1, 2. Can you hear me?
Yes,
Rezzy's in the building.
All right. It'd be better if she's closer to the mic though, because it's some delays are happening.
All right. Can you hear me now? Is that better?
It is better. I just sometimes it breaks up and I just have to listen closer. That's fine.
Thank you. And thank you so much for your patience, for calling back, for hanging in there. It's, you know, there's, although like we were just talking about the 2020 connection and how we can work remotely and do all of these things, like you don't have to come into the studio. We can do this on the internet.
No.
But these are some of the drawbacks, you know, until we can get this thing straightened out. Unfortunately, you know, there's not much we can do about it. But thank you so much.
You know, the interesting thing about, are we back on?
Yes, we are. Yes, we are.
I think the interesting thing is about working remotely is that, again, through this experience of the Selectrix project, I think we initially started really getting serious about things, thinking down the line. I guess that was maybe 2011, 2012, something like that. And, you know, also when you're traveling, if you want the expression, as I was mentioning earlier, I mean, you want to continue your life's experience. And so if you're stuck in the studio 24/7, how are you going to see the sunshine? How are you going to, you know, embrace nature, you know, or just the basic things that that are inspiring for you, for me at least, to write music. So traveling around, and as now it has been termed, I guess, they do travel blogs. We were sort of just doing that naturally, you know, during the times when we were writing or sometimes just collaborating, sending those files back and forth, because we realized that life was going to change. And also, you know, it's expensive to go in the studio all the time when you can basically become a lot more self-sufficient you know, get your own microphone, get your correct speakers. You know, I've been like, I started collecting vintage keyboards and things like that, you know, years ago. You know, just investing in yourself and learning. There's so much that you can do on your own now that gives, you know, like the sky is the limit. Is what you can do, how you can sing your music, how you can get your music heard. So we always sort of like came from that perspective of now here we are in COVID-19 and we have to find different alternatives.
Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
I believe you're still on. It cut her off. Jesus Christ.
Oh. Okay.
It cut her off. It cut her off, people. I apologize for that. Wanda.
Can you get her back on your actual phone?
But not so that you all can hear. And no, the answer
to
that.
So let me ask a question. Just like you're talking to us on the microphone, can you use your telephone and it come through?
I don't have her number.
Oh.
So I can't do that.
Gotcha.
Wanda, please, please, please express our apologies. I was not able to wrap up the show the way I would have ordinarily done it. However, I am so appreciative of her coming on. It was fascinating, amazing. Please, please, please express our apologies to her.
We got to get her back where she can come. It'd be a lot easier if she came on and did a visual, because that way she'd be on the same system, which is great. You know,
exactly. Yeah. And which is one of the reasons why we try to have our artists come on the air, you know, like come on the video with us, because it's less likely that we'll have a difficulty. The other thing, though, is that I'm impressed that we were able to speak for as long as we were.
Yes, and we can do a part two. Wonderful. Thank you, Wanda. And Wanda Tidline.
Yes.
The very, 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 very multifaceted Wanda Tidline is one of our co-producers on the show. And, you know, she's amazing and she helps us keep it together on the end, too. She and Pop. So
that's right.
Thank you, Wanda.
Yes, thank you so much, and thank you for stepping up today. Pops stepped out for a second to get some air and have a little well-deserved vacation time.
Fun on his bun.
Yeah, and Wanda steps in, and that's how we do. So what I'm going to do is I am going to play a song, the song that I had queued up. She was really speaking about a collaboration on this song. Wave of Love, and I'm gonna play this, and then we're just gonna make it out. Yes, we will be more than happy to do a part two, and hopefully she will come on the video so that you know, we can do it seamlessly, or at least without the drop there.
Yes.
Because usually when the system doesn't work, I'm the only one that fades out, and Therese and the artist remain. And let me just thank you, Therese. You just smooth sail. When no matter what happens, you just keep it running. And thank you, thank you, thank you.
There are always going to be things in life that are beyond our control. And the only thing you do control is your response to it. So, you know, I know you're going to be back up. I know what you're doing. I know what's happening.
You call me silky, but you are smooth. Together, we are silky smooth. That's all I'm going to say. All right. She be handling her shit. She's like, you know, it's just how you respond to it. Things going to happen. That was a smooth response.
What you going to do? You know? Life is limited. Let's not spit it complaining. Let's just move.
Like, why are you going to cry over spilled milk? Just wipe the shit up and keep on, right?
We know exactly. Like, you know, perspective is key in everything right now. You know, you could spend time, you can't get back yelling and screaming about it, or you could just move it along and, you know, and be grateful that we have people like Wanda Tyndale that could make it happen again. So
absolutely. And N'Dea said to tell us all, you know, thanks very much. But tell her we said thank you, and we really appreciate her spending time. I felt like there was a lot of education in there, and because I'm so busy, you know, doing this and doing that, I can't listen to every single word. But
I did. I listened, you know, I listened to every single word. Yeah, she was dropping some nuggets for
exactly.
us.
Exactly. You know? I have to, this is one of those shows that I have to watch again and really listen to every word, because, you know, especially when someone calls as opposed to they're right there, like I'm still, even if they're on the video, you know me, I'm like a damn, I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm always trying to fix everything. But I'm not paying 100% attention while I'm doing everything. But every time I was able to focus, I was like, oh, right. Wow. Really?
Yeah. She reminded us of some crap that's still going on, you know, and quite frankly, we're not here for it anymore. And it's just the idea that we women have, been kind of nameless and faceless unless you are up front singing. And then even when you're up front singing, that's what they kind of relegate to you to being. And you could have had, you could be everywhere. You could be, you know, you could be writing, you could be producing, you could be arranging. And quite frankly, a lot of us have been behind the scenes. You know, I'm just sitting here thinking about how many things that I know that Faith Evans has written, you know, on. And, you know, and unless you know her particular style of sound, you may not know until you read those things. And what we lost in this digital era is our liner notes, where, you know, you would go and you would see right. all the stuff credited. And even then, some people didn't make the credits, but actually contributed to the situation. You understand? So, I mean, what it is right now, this is a valuable point that she made about just making sure that when you are doing things with folk, there is a level of integrity about it. And when you are doing things with folks, make sure that the business of music is handled, because, you know, we got a lot of talented people out in the world that have done some amazing things, and their business wasn't in order. And you know, it is the music business first. And unfortunately, it can be quite discouraging. And it goes back to what we always talk about on the show, JaVonne, about your camps, your team, and what you're able to do, you know. But now in this new age of creating music, you can own all of your stuff, everything, you know. If you have a fan base and a platform, you can create, you can write, you can do things, as long as you have, you know, there's still a certain amount of, depending on what your sound is, or I guess what your, you know, whatever it is, because it doesn't have to be music. It can be anything you want to produce, because you have a platform that can sell it. You have aggregators out there that can sell stuff for you. You can create your website. This is so, we are in such a great place with being independent. You know, you have a platform, you have a sound, you want to create some stuff, you get your team together, you can do it all, because all the record companies did anyway. They just did it on a larger scale. But also they took back from on a larger scale too. So you do the balancing, you know. Do you want a big machine behind you in your pocket for duration and limited, and possibly your scope with uncreative folk possibly engineering or A&Ring your brand? Or do you want to do it independent, do it your way, which may take a little longer, but you know, just like anything, we cook. When it's stove for a long time, it tastes better.
Absolutely. I mean, look at this show. Look at this show.
Another example.
You know?
Another example.
So that's what's up. And we're growing. And actually, I'm thinking about it, and I'm going to talk to you about it before I make the move. But there's another human being I want to bring on board with us, you know? And the human beings that have been in our circle are amazing. That are a part of this show. So just so that everybody knows, I don't think we made like any a formal announcement, because we're not a formal show. We're really a family show to some degree. That doesn't mean have your children sit and watch the show. No, That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that everyone who is a part of the show is like family. So, you know me, I'm JaVonne, and you know Therese, and you know background Betty is Monifa, and you know Ulysses Carter as Pops. And we also recently have added, and we are fortunate to have Wanda Tidline along with us, who has been booking agent to the stars for like forever, for maybe a couple of decades. And we've had Wanda on the show as a guest previously, and it's funny, I had Therese a couple of times as a guest before she came on, and we had to almost put a gun to Pop's head to have him as a guest. But I'm behind the scenes, Jay. I'm behind the scenes. Come up here and say a few words. So we're going to have Wanda back on eventually as well, so that everybody can meet her.
Yes.
And, so that, you know, everybody knows who we are as a team. We're a team, and I think, you know, one of the wonderful things is that we are a team that we're solid. We're people of color, intelligent, passionate, creative, and we want to bring you the best product we can. All of us, each of us, always striving for the best, you know. And when there are glitches, I think it hurts each of us, you know. I think we all feel like, but you all, the other part of the team that watches and supports us, you're probably the most important part of the team, because without you, we just chit-chatting with each other. And, you know, Loretta, we thank you. Sonia, I don't know if you're watching now, but you probably will watch later. We thank you.
Yeah.
Those are my two road dogs, my ride or dies, that, you know, if I do a lot of pop-up shows, you might see that happen from time to time. I will call them and ask them, yo, y'all ready? Like maybe 10 minutes before I'm about to do a pop-up show. And the pop-up show is just like, I'll be playing music and whatnot, but you'll see me asking them, could they call in? Could somebody come on the line? Because I'm trying to work out some kinks. What happened today? I can't even, Block Talk Later Radio was like, you know what? I don't feel like it no more. And shut off. And shut me down. I was like, oh shit.
We also have P Boogie, that always pops in and shows love. Debbie Turner, who pops in here, like Walt Taylor, our studio co-host, so to speak, that just, you know, keep us balanced and say wonderful things and, you know, and contribute. Okay.
Peggy Miller, when she feels like it,
you know? Peggy Miller popping in.
Not for nothing. If you are one of those behind the scenes people that's always watching the show, but you don't like to comment, you don't like to, you know, say what's going on, or you have nothing to say, you just want to watch, you know, one of those voyeurs, you know, you want to just watch and see.
Like Tiffy Red and Lulu.
Yeah, we see you. We see you. We feel you. Let's put it like that. We may not be able to see you, but we feel you, and we do appreciate you. Yeah. There are a lot of people that watch this show, but there are not enough. If you know one other person who might enjoy this show,
share it.
Tell them. Remind them. You know, link it onto their page. Post it. You know somebody who used to be into or is into the Brand New Heavies or N'Dea Davenport? Post it. And if you're from Jersey, New York, or that particular area, Wednesday night, you might want to tune in, especially if you like house music, especially if you like gospel house music.
Ooh.
Kenny Bobian is coming, and he sent me a new track. We're gonna have to save it for the next show, Wanda. We will we will do it next time, if that's okay. I'm getting bells. because I'm not really sure if it's even gonna work on my phone. So to have her go through that, please tell her that we would like a short return. We would like for her to come back quickly, as soon as she can.
Yeah, she was just getting warmed up. She was just getting warmed up.
I know. We were just getting there. So she has a lot more. She has a lot more. So, you know, I don't know that this is going to work. I actually have every bit of a gadget of gadgets to hook it up so that my phone can link up, and I got cords and everything. I know how to do it, but it's not a guarantee that it's going to work. So this is one of the reasons why I like to rehearse things, just to make sure everything is going to work. So, but we'll get that set up next time. But tell her much love, and I hope she enjoyed the little bit of time. Well, actually, she was on for an hour, but it was a little bit of time because we were just getting to know one another, and it felt like she was on for 5 minutes. You know what I'm saying? We were just getting there, and I think
I could tell if I didn't know before, I could tell that she's definitely got a lot on her mind.
Yes.
Definitely got more to say, and I'm here for it. Like I told her, I'm grateful that she wants to share, and I can't wait for new stuff.
Yep, and this is the place we want her to come back here to share it. So Wanda, we'll talk offline about when we can have her back soon and very soon. Going back to the top of the show, right? See how I did that? You see how I did? I used to be queen of the segues, but you know, sometimes.
We have our own silent jokes here.
You know what I'm saying? I'm saying. All right. So what I want to do is I do want to play a new jam that was sent to me. It's called Magical Ride. It's dope. I listened to it. And also, she has to come back because there are more songs that were sent to me that we didn't get to dissect. And I love when an artist writes the material that they send me so that they can talk about it. Because sometimes I might have a question. And sometimes, Rezzy, you might have a question. So, you know, we both appreciate it. So thank you so much. We're going to do this. And then, you know what? Maybe we'll save that too. Maybe we'll save the new song for next time. And we will end with this. We'll just end with the outro. I just wish I would have put more of Monifa on there because she is a scream. You tell background Betty that she is in my thoughts today and I am cracking up about the whole thing. I love you to pieces, Rez. I love all of y'all.
Peace party people. See you later. Hey, P Boogie. See you later, babe. We love you.
Yes, we do. We love you. We love you. We love you. We love you. We absolutely freaking love you. Now I can't find the daggone thing with the mo clip. Where's the mo clip?
What's up? It's your girl Monifa, and you're tuned in to Brunch in the Basement with JaVonne and Terez.
Still in the basement, no longer alone, with my homegirl Terez on the microphone. Music, politics, or just chatting it up. Brunch in the basement, see that's what's up. You never know who might run through. Legendary artists or someone brand new. You miss a lot when you miss one day. At least that's what I heard somebody say. But it doesn't really matter what whoever says. It's always a good show with JaVonne and Terez. Yeah. Brunch in the basement with JaVonne and Terez. Yeah. Let's see who we got today or what we doing today or whatever it is, it's gonna be good. Woo!
Yeah.
I'm on Everybody's a Friend in my head. I already know everybody. one day I'll tell you about me and Chaka Khan, but you know.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. But she doesn't know anything about it. But anyway. No, she doesn't. She wasn't even there, actually. But anyway.
With time, so
and we thank you for that.
Thank you.
Yes, thank
well,
you.
Thank you. This part, that little piece, I'm just gonna keep and play it all the time for myself. But no, I'm just teasing.